I used to think motion capture was only for big studios, until I built my own for a fraction of the cost. Did you know professional motion capture suits can cost up to $50,000? I built mine for a tiny fraction of that, using an ESP32 microcontroller and an MPU6050 gyroscope. I created a DIY tracking system that captures movement and sends the data directly to applications like Touchdesigner and React.js. In this video, I will take you through everything: designing, soldering, 3D printing the closure, and programming the software. I went through dozens of iterations to get this right, so you don't have to. By the end of this video, you will know exactly how to track movement using these affordable components, how the data gets sent through WebSockets, and just how accurate this DIY system is compared to high-end solutions. Plus, I'll share tips to help you avoid some of the mistakes I made along the way so you can get your system up and running without the headaches. Let's face it, high-end motion capture systems are amazing, but the price, not so much. For most makers, artists, or indie developers, spending thousands of dollars just isn't an option. Back in 2022, I tried building my own system with 4 sensors, one for each limb. I used an Arduino Nano and even wrote a custom RF communication protocol. Obviously, it was a disaster. The data was glitchy, the range was terrible, and the Arduino just wasn't powerful enough. Then I discovered this, the Lilgo T-Display S3. It's an ESP32-based board with built-in Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and a small TFT display. Paired with the MPU6050 gyroscope, it was the perfect foundation for this project. And the best part? It's cheap, scalable, and can transmit data using WebSockets to connected clients like Touchdesigner for interactive visuals and React.js for web-based applications. Here is the game plan. We are going to build a motion capture system step by step. The core components are the Lilgo T-Display S3, which processes the motion data and sends it via Wi-Fi, an MPU6050 gyroscope and accelerometer sensor for motion tracking, a push button to change between modes, a vibration motor to provide haptic feedback to the user, a 3.7-volt LiPo battery to make this project portable, a 3D printed enclosure to hold everything neat, and a Node.js server to broadcast the data to clients like Touchdesigner. So the MPU6050 is an amazing sensor that's super cheap and widely available. It tracks both linear and rotational motion in 3 axes. But while it's powerful, the raw data can be really noisy. Don't worry, I will show you how to filter the data later on. Soldering is also a critical part for this build. I'll be wiring the MPU6050 to the Lilgo board, making sure the connections are clean and secure. If you're new to soldering, take your time. But connections can cause all sorts of headaches down the line. Before we enclose everything in the case, we'll test the system to make sure that all the components are working together properly. We'll start by understanding how the MPU6050 works and why filtering its raw data is so important. Then I'll show you how the data flows through the ESP32 and is transmitted over Wi-Fi to multiple devices. By the end, you'll have a fully functional system that can integrate into everything from real-time visuals to VR applications. The MPU6050 is the heart of the system. It combines a 3-axis accelerometer and a 3-axis gyroscope. That means it can track both tilt and rotational movement, making it perfect for motion capture. But the raw data isn't always usable straight out of the box. That's why we are going to filter them. Sounds simple, right? In reality, the math behind is a pain. Well, thank God this video is a generic tutorial. But if you're interested in learning how this sensor works, read my essay for the full technical details and functionality of the MPU6050 from the link in the description. Now, in order to clean up the data, I implemented exponential smoothing, which averages out small fluctuations and focuses on significant movements. Here is how it works in code. This creates a smoother, more stable data stream that's much easier to work with. Once we have smoothed out the raw data, the next step is just as critical. Calibration! Calibration ensures that our sensor readings are accurate and account for any offsets caused by slight imperfections in the sensor or its placement. Here's the calibration process I implemented. Over a fixed duration, in this case 3 seconds, the sensor collects a series of readings, averages them, and then stores the offsets for each axis. This accounts for things like the sensor's natural drift and the constant pull of gravity on the accelerometer. This process takes just a few seconds, but it's essential for ensuring consistent, accurate readings. For example, the accelerometer calibration subtracts gravity from the z-axis, which is critical for correctly interpreting the sensor's movement. Once the offsets are calculated, they're applied to every new reading to correct the raw data. Let me show you how this works in practice. With calibration and filtering working together, the data becomes much more reliable. This means smoother, more accurate motion capture, even in real-time applications like Touchdesigner. As you can see, the calibrated data is far more stable, making the setup ready for precise motion tracking in any project. Designing the enclosure was a journey in itself, because I suck. My first version didn't have the space for the battery, so I went back to the Fusion 360. The second version added a button, but the button dimensions was too small in the third version. Finally, the fourth version fit everything perfectly, but it still requires precise placement for the components. If you use my models, first of all, God bless you, and you need to use M2 threaded inserts and M2 screws. In this project, I used 10mm screws. The STL models, code, schematics, and documentation files can be found in my GitHub page from the link in the description. The worst mistake I did in this project was to polish the case. That took more than I want to admit. I was sanding the case for 3 hours. This step is definitely not necessary, but it definitely makes the final product feel more professional, and I have definitely regretted it. The ESP32 is what makes the system so powerful. The Lilgo T display uses an ESP32S3 chip. The device uses access point plus station mode to connect to an existing Wi-Fi network and create its own access point. That means you can use your phone or any other device in order to provide Wi-Fi credentials and the server IP to the device. This makes it perfect for exhibitions or quick setups where you don't want to reconfigure the code. Here's how the data transmission works. The ESP32 sends motion data from the gyroscope to a Node.js server. The server then broadcasts this data to all connected clients. This means you can have multiple applications, like Touchdesigner, React, or any other WebSocket client receiving the same data at the same time. Yoohoo! The Node.js relay server listens for incoming data from the ESP32 and broadcasts it to all connected clients. Here's how it works. This setup isn't just powerful, it's also scalable. You could easily add more sensors using a multiplex module or use the same infrastructure for other IoT projects. Here is the fun part, putting everything together. The motion data is being streamed in real time to Touchdesigner. Here it's controlling this 3D cube thing, whatever it is. The rotation values of this 3D model are mapped to the sensor data, and so the model moves exactly as I move the device. You can see how smoothly it reacts to my movements. But this system isn't just for visuals. I also built a React application with 3.js that lets you use this motion data in a web browser. This opens up endless possibilities, from VR controllers to interactive installations. In the React app, it's as simple as this. We use a use effect hook in order to retrieve the data using WebSockets. This project started with a messy Arduino prototype and evolved into a fully functional real-time motion capture system. It's open source, affordable, and fully modular. I call it M+. I don't know why. Maybe it means motion plus data. If this inspired you, hit like, subscribe, and check out the links in the description. The code, schematics, and detailed written versions of this tutorial are all available on my blog and GitHub page. I would love to see what you build with this system. Fork the repository and share your projects. Thanks for watching.